Thank you for the introduction. I'm very pleased to give you an overview of my current work in Gerhard Starke's group. I worked on curved, on least squares methods on curved boundary, and today I will do that for elasticity, and in particular related to the mixed finite element method for elasticity. So the basic, the basis of the work on curved boundaries was published in these papers. In these papers together. So the first one proves the convergence of the least squares methods on a domain with curved boundaries approximated by polygonal boundaries. The second one extends the analysis to the higher order elements, so you will need parametric elements and polynomial approximation of the boundary. And today I concentrate on the least squares method for the part on the curved boundary, but the result holds in the mixed method, in general mixed method, so that will be the third paper. And the formulation I will use for the linear elasticity is a new one that I will present. It's due to Kai and Park. Okay, so first we call notation on linear elasticity. So you have, like in the previous talk, some plate that has a reference configuration, omega, that is subject to some forces, F, such that you get the momentum balance. And linear elasticity means linear relationships between components of stress and displacements that you get here with the Lamé parameter mu and lambda. So you have also displacement boundary condition on some part of the boundary, and on other part you have some triaxial force here. So one problem is we can scale that problem such that mu is equal to 1. But you get trouble with the lambda if it stands by the infinity. So what you do, one possibility will be to insert some pressure here for that term. And another one is to use the inverse operator, because that remains well defined when lambda turns to the infinity. And then we write some A instead of the C operator, because you cannot invert it again. So this is the first order system then. And if you test the first equation, that would be in H-diff, you get the first equation of the Hillinger-Reisner formulation. Subject to the condition, this will be the momentum balance. And this is some symmetric condition. So you have to prove some stability, and that works, for example, with quadratic Rabier-Thomas element, linear discontinuous element for the displacement, and some other matrix polynomials, also linear, for the approximation of the symmetry. So, of course, you have a mixed method in that case, so momentum balance is as best as possible. And for the stress approximation, you get with some regularity assumptions and the interpolation operator, you get h to the power of alpha. I wanted to mark this in red because we will use this h to the power of alpha in the comparison. So yet, now we are going to the least squares methods. And very shortly, only the notations such that we are going to compare the method and to see the problem of curved boundaries. So we have, as usual, a linear first order differential operator, and we want to approximate the solution of the first order system Q equal to F. You minimize the L2 norm to get your least squares functional. So you have the first order necessary condition that leads to the variational formulation. And a sufficient condition for a unique solution is that energy balance. And then you do that again. If you discretize, you get your finite dimensional subspace. you minimize the same least squares functional in the discrete space. You get the same variational formulation in the discrete space. And with some interpolation operator, we get automatically convergence if VH is a subspace of V, and the inherent error control. So, and the problem of the curved boundary we will see later is that in that case, VH, it's not a subspace of V, and then we have to reprove all the, we get an additional term, and we have to keep track of that error into the whole method. Okay, so for the linear elasticity, if you use the first order system you had on the second slide, you get this least squares functional. And you can discretize with linear Ravier-Thomas element and linear continuous polynomials for the displacement or quadratic, or something like that. And you get the convergence results from 2004 from Kai and Gerhard. They get h to the power of k if you use a Ravier-Thomas space of degree k. And now you get it related with the h of to the power of alpha, because if you look at the momentum balance, of course it's not a mixed method, so that's not as fast as possible. But here you are able to get again this h to the power of alpha multiplied by the residuals. So it will be an improved convergence of the momentum balance. And I wanted to give you the idea of the proof, but I will do that for the second formulation because it works in the same way. So the second formulation, the square formulation for linear elasticity, the new one, you introduced some vorticity variable. Yes, because the problem of the last one is that you have no symmetry condition, so symmetry will not be improved. Will be automatically converge, but not improve. And in that one, you introduce some vorticity variable, such that you are able to have a third condition that is that the stress tensor has to be symmetric. So the least squares functional is again the residuals in the L2 norm, and you can discretize again with Ravier-Thomas and continuous polynomial of same order, and yet then you get some additional polynomials of degree d minus 1 for the last equation. So the convergence phase, so ellipticity and continuity from the least squares functional was proved by Kai and Park. And also in that case, you get your improved momentum balance. So recall this h to the power of alpha. It's that convergence order that you get from the mixed method. And this will be the least square, the error in the least squares functional norm. To get that, you first break up your momentum balance term such that you want to escape this error from F. And this will be also some problem because this is remaining. So your approximation on F has to be good enough. Then you can change your norm by a supremum, of course. And now you can do the same technique as in the Brains paper. You use an auxiliary problem. So introduce new problem with set H being some variable from the space of the mixed formulation, and eta being the displacement variable for that. So, of course, the next step is then to change this, you will be set, and then do you change this one into the R, that is your new variable from the auxiliary problem. And as this is going to be the exact solution on eta, you can insert whatever you want to that term to get the least squares functional, because this will be zero. So, and then, due to the fact that that is the exact solution of the least squares functional, you can, if you use the right space here for some approximation, inserting some approximation from this auxiliary problem that belong to the right space. You just have to take care that eta h gamma h and r h are variables that you have the elasticity from the least squares formulation. So, and if you use the same from the mixed formulation, then this will be the approximation. You can take the approximation of this auxiliary problem with the mixed method, and this will be also great. And then you have here on the left side the error in the least squares functional norm, and on the right side the error due to the mixed method approximation, and that will be to the power of h alpha. So here you will get h to the power of alpha, and here you will get your least squares functional. So you have here again some improved momentum balance, and it's also important to have that because it's directly related to the approximation of the boundary trace, because if you estimate of some part of the boundary where you are not setting traction force, you estimate the force. You can estimate that by the divergence of the stress tensor, and that will be the improved convergence. But if you want to have accuracy approximation of the boundary trace on the boundary, then that will be great to have a good approximation of the boundary, and also in the higher order. So for that, you will have to use parametric Ravier-Summers elements, because the estimation of the flux by in Ravier-Summers elements is not as so well known as this case. This case is for scalar functions, so you have some scalar function p that's set to zero on the approximated boundary, and we want to estimate that on the curved boundary. So that's the isoparametric case, and it's well known that you can bound the norm of p by in the L2 norm by some h to the power of k plus 1/2 by the norm of p in the 1 norm. But in if you are doing that for Ravier-Thomas elements, then it's not so well known, because you have to you don't want to approximate the function in each dimension. You want to approximate the flux. And yeah, that was part of the previous work. So here's a slide just to recall the elements. So Ravier-Thomas elements in the lower order have three freedom degree that approximated the normal component on each edge. And then if you use some curved domain, you have to use curved triangulation. So it's only some theoretical notation to get to get omega covered with all the triangles. And of course, if you take the regular triangle corresponding to the curved one, you get an approximation of the boundary and an approximation of the domain. And then you are able to prove that the normal flux of Ravier-Thomas function, that will be a Ravier-Thomas function, that vanish on the approximated boundary, you can bound that by the Ravier-Thomas function on the domain. To prove that, you use the special form of the Ravier-Thomas function in because they have a special form if they vanish on the boundary. So you get an estimate for L2 norm, but you get if you should screw in L2, you get only h to the power on 1/2. So then you can choose q in h1 and integrate by parts. Then you get an additional h, and then you use the interpolation property and get h here. Then you have to keep track the this error and the whole method, and that will be the theorem. So it's only keeping track in the equivalences you see in the least squares slide, and you get the results that using the approximated boundary retain your convergence order if you use linear elements. This was a test. I wanted to have an exact solution for that, so they, it's not symmetric. You have some forces on the domain that going from there to there. And also, it's vanishing on the boundary. And here you get the result. So in the linear order case, you retain your convergence order. And if you use higher order elements, yeah, I forgot to put the 1, 1. And this will be not 2, it's something like 1.5. And that's a problem. And so you have, for the next higher order case, you will have to use parametric elements. So then you get a polynomial approximation of the boundary, that one, using the isoparametric framework to get your construction of F that mapped the polygonal approximation to the polynomial one. But here you have to be careful for transformation of the Raga-Thomas element. And if you do that and build that in the space, then you are able to prove the error estimate for the flux on the curve boundary, sorry, for functions that vanish on the approximated one. You get your error on h to the power of k plus 1, so this is the same order as the method. So you're able to keep track of this error in the whole method and getting the theorem that using the parametric finite element approximation retain your convergence order in the higher order case too. And here's another example. If you use lower order elements, you get your normal convergence rate. If you don't, if you use the polygonal approximation, but with the higher order elements, you get nothing optimal. And if you get the higher, if you take the higher order elements with the higher order approximation and the parametric transformation, then you are able to retain your convergence order. Here's some benchmark problem to close this talk and to get the get it applied, because the problem before was only some theoretical problem with vanishing forces. So this is benchmark problem from, normally you have a bigger plate, but you are able to take only a force of your domain, and you have some traction force on the top. This was a slide to recall the freedoms degree you have if you use quadratic Raga-Thomas elements, quadratic for the stress tensor, quadratic elements for the displacement, and linear for the vorticity. This will be the refinement of the domain. So we refine on each step 20% of the triangle. This is the optimal convergence rate. And the important one is on the next. These are the results compared to the other least squares functionals that don't have the vorticity. That quite similar. Of course, this one is higher because you have an additional condition. And here you can see that the momentum balance is improved. So if you use quadratic elements, your h to the power of alpha will be 2 for the mixed method. And here the least squares functional converge with a convergence of 2, and the momentum balance have an additional order of 2. This concludes my talk. I have to generalize that to nonlinear elasticity. Gerhard and some colleagues on Essen has generalized the old version of the least squares functional to nonlinear elasticity. So there are good chances that we can generalize that one, and maybe some elastodynamics or something like that. Thank you.
Very nice, got us back on schedule as well. We had a little bit late start with the projector. Are there any questions? Well, let's thank our speakers.